It's the latest flashpoint in Britain's agonising Brexit, the country's highest court being dragged into battle.
Lord Reid's observations are...
While protesters bay at the doors, the real fight over a five-week government suspension or prorogation of Parliament rages inside.
Ongoing and issues around the approach to be taken.
Lawyers for critics of the government argue it was an undemocratic and illegal move.
The Prime Minister's motive was to silence Parliament for that period because he sees Parliament as an obstacle to the furtherance of his political aims.
Not true, says the government, but even if it was, it's a matter of political judgment, not law, say the government's lawyers.
We are dealing with a prerogative power. It's a prerogative power that has been expressly preserved by Parliament.
Lower British courts have already issued conflicting rulings on the issue, leaving it to the 11 judges sitting here in the Supreme Court in London to decide which view should prevail. It's important because it's an extraordinary use of the British court system to check the power of the Prime Minister. And the final decision could have a profound impact on the way this country works. It could also have an impact on Boris Johnson, whose first weeks as British Prime Minister have been dogged by public heckles.
But you're not done. When you should be in Brussels negotiating, where's the negotiation going on?
There's also the unprecedented loss of his first six votes in Parliament.
The noes to the left, 46.
And even an embarrassing diplomatic snub in the tiny European state of Luxembourg, where he was empty-chaired by its Prime Minister. The decision of the Supreme Court back in Britain could deliver yet another humiliation. Matthew Chance, CNN London.
It was a long list of foreign leaders that President Trump communicated with in the weeks before the whistleblower spoke up. But the Washington Post reports that the complaint, which the intelligence community inspector general says is of urgent concern, centers on Ukraine, which the president has had controversial dealings with. Just 2.5 weeks before the complaint was filed on August 12th, the president spoke with his Ukrainian counterpart, Trump today insisting it was all above board.
I've had conversations with many leaders. They're always appropriate.
At the time, the White House said the two presidents discussed strengthening the relationship without giving specifics. But Ukraine said they talked about the investigation of corruption cases, which inhibited the interaction between Ukraine and the USA. In May, the president's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, said he was going to Ukraine to push the new president to investigate Joe Biden and his son's links to a gas company. He canceled the trip, but then in July went to Madrid to meet with an aide to President Zelensky to talk about Biden. Then, the next month, $250 million in military aid for Ukraine was put on hold by the White House. On September 1st, Vice President Mike Pence met with Zelensky. When asked about the efforts to get dirt on Joe Biden, the vice president danced around it.
As President Trump had me made clear, we have great concerns about issues of corruption. And fortunately, President Zelensky was elected decisively on an anti-corruption message.
Whatever the alleged promise that the whistleblower says the president reportedly made, Democrats in Congress are vowing to get to the bottom of those claims.
They deserve a thorough investigation. That's what we're intent on doing. And come hell or high water, that's what we're going to do.
Boko Haram is an Islamic militant group operating in Nigeria. Their name loosely translates to Western education is forbidden. Their first major known attack was on multiple police stations in 2003 in the northeast part of the country. But they gained notoriety when they kidnapped more than 200 schoolgirls in April 2014. Boko Haram's aim is to create an Islamic State and control large parts of northeast Nigeria. But the group has lost significant territory in the last year, partly thanks to an increased campaign by the Nigerian military, working in coalition with countries like Chad and Cameroon, who neighbor Nigeria. The new president, Muhammadu Buhari, has also moved Nigeria's military headquarters closer to Boko Haram territory in the north. But despite pushing back and the significant gains the military has made against the terror group, top military officials know that it will not be considered a success until the missing Chibok girls are found.